Hey, happy Independence Day. This is the weekend we're celebrating our nation's independence, and I'm sitting in front of one of my favorite places in Lebanon, Connecticut. I have lots of favorite places in the outdoors, but in terms of buildings, this is one of my favorites. This here is the pastor's library, and it was a library that was donated and funds raised by the First Congregational Church, and it sits over here in this area of the historic society where there's lots of buildings and lots of fun places to visit. And I'm welcoming you to our worship service this morning, but I do hope that sometime this summer, if you get to Lebanon, if you're not here already, that you take some time to come and visit and celebrate the rich history of our small town of Lebanon with a great big giant heart and a really awesome community. So welcome to worship on this Independence Day celebration weekend. I'm glad you're here. It's all of us as community, our churches, our people, our families that make this community what it is. So we'll see ya.
Greetings. Welcome to the First Congregational Church of Lebanon, United Church of Christ. I'm the Reverend Dr. Will Sensabaugh, and I am the pastor here at this congregation. I'm so very glad that you are here with me in this virtual space, and together we will worship God. Hopefully, this service will bring joy to your heart, lift your spirit, help you on the path of your spiritual journey. Again, I say, welcome.
In your house, O Lord, we ponder your steadfast love.
Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised.
How beautiful is your creation, O God.
Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised.
We give thanks for this day and the beauty of creation.
Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised.
Let the whole world rejoice in your love and mercy.
Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised.
Died, land of the pilgrims' pride.
dynamic and always speaking God, thank you for your continued guidance and presence in our lives. We live in a complex and noisy world, O Lord, and we are easily distracted by the things of the world. Train us to hear your voice above the din, God, no matter who it is who speaks your word to us. Train us also, God, to be prophets in this world, speaking your grace and peace to all in need. Bless us in our human weaknesses so that through your grace we may be made strong. We ask this in the name of your Son. Amen.
As it was in the beginning, is now.
now time for the church at prayer, and I'm going to offer a brief prayer and then invite you to pray with me the Lord's Prayer. So let us now join together and be in the spirit of prayer. God of the pilgrim, we ask your presence with us on our journey of life. Help us to be faithful to your ways of love and grace. Keep us from helpless despair. Give us the power to make your love known, even in this world that seems so bent on war and hate. With your courage in our hearts, we will walk the Jerusalem road together. Help us, Lord, to use the freedom that we have to build a kingdom where we can demonstrate your spirit through worship and witness, and we can minister to the needs of the people in the church and the community. All this we ask in the name of Jesus, who taught his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
From the book of Mark, chapter 6. He left that place and came to his hometown, and his disciples followed him. On the Sabbath, he began to teach in the synagogue. And many who heard him were astounded. They said, "Where did this man get all this? What is this wisdom that has been given to him? What deeds of power are being done by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, and brother of James, and Joseph, and Judas, and Simon? And are not his sisters here with us?" And they took offense at him. Then Jesus said to them, "Prophets are not without honor, except in their hometown, and among their own kin, and in their own house." And he could do no deed of power there, except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and cured them. And he was amazed at their unbelief. Then he went about among the villages teaching. He called the 12 and began to send them out two by two and gave them authority over the unclean spirits. He ordered them to take nothing for their journey except a staff, no bread, no bag, no money in their belts, but to wear sandals and not to put on two tunics. He said to them, "Wherever you enter a house, stay there until you leave the place. If any place will not welcome you and they refuse to hear you as you leave, shake off the dust that is on your feet as a testimony against them." So they went out and proclaimed that all should repent. They cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and cured them.
Jesus had a vision and a mission statement. And the vision was short and could easily be fit onto a bumper sticker. In fact, you may have even seen it on a bumper sticker. Repent, the kingdom of God is at hand. And he lived his whole life and carried out his ministry with that vision in mind. Repent, that is, turn your life around and get right with God. And the kingdom of God is at hand, which means the kingdom of God is all around you. Make this world a better place. A mission statement is a thing that usually gets put on company literature, and the employees are supposed to know exactly what it means and live it out. But the mission usually comes about when the executives of a company go off on a retreat and they brainstorm. And they all feel really good about that statement. And then they put it on posters and they plaster it all around the company. But the hourly employees, well, sometimes they don't sign on. I mean, they agree with the statement, they agree with the statements, but they aren't really guided and given direction. And there's usually a little follow through on the mission, which causes it to be cast aside for the next great thing. See, the workers see right through it, and then they become more wary each time. Jesus had a mission, and he shared it with his disciples a few times. However, they didn't really understand the mission. In fact, we're still pretty unclear about what his mission was. And we can't seem to agree on the mission of Jesus. So we came up with our own. Thus it is written that we seek to demonstrate God's Spirit through worship and witness and ministry to the needs of the people in the church and the community. Okay, we changed some words, but the idea hasn't changed. On some corporate retreat, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit got together and they formulated a mission. They may have brainstormed and spitballed a bunch of ideas. They may have thrown a few theories of atonement against the wall to see what stuck. And in the end, this is what they came back with. Repent. The kingdom of God is at hand. Then they shared it with the apostles. And then the 12 apostles didn't quite understand it, but they shared it with hundreds of disciples that gathered to hear them. And then those disciples shared it with their families and their friends. And then the apostles gathered for their corporate meeting. They were the body of Christ, after all. Except now stood before them their CEO, the great divine motivational speaker and consultant, stood before them with broiled fish in one hand and a Sharpie in the other. They tried to organize a short time after the resurrection. And here we are, 2,000 years later. We come seeking, full of awe, full of wonder, full of questions. What are we going to do now? See, our worship service isn't about coming together to pat ourselves on the back for what a wonderful job we think we're doing. We gather here as the Congregational Church of Lebanon to inspire one another to carry out our mission, because we believe that we should demonstrate God's Spirit through worship and witness and ministry to the needs of the people in the church and the community. It's who we are. It's what we do. Once upon a time, in a beautiful little town, there was a church. And this church was made up of people who loved their church very much. They were Congregationalists, and they loved the congregation, the people who made up the church. At one point, this very special church was in need of a new pastor. And the new pastor was young, and he was full of hope. And the congregation was full of hope for the future as well. And the new pastor came to the church with many new ideas. The paint, it was falling off of the steeple, and the sound system, it was in need of a boost. And these things were addressed by the pastor in his first year. And the church looked as beautiful on the outside as the people did on the inside. Their beautiful white steepled church was truly a source of pride for them. And the people came each Sunday to hear and to see the work of the Holy Spirit. They marveled at the new sound system. It was expensive, but the people knew that they were worth it. And certainly God wanted them to hear the worship service. The pastor knew that another need for the church would be a new organ. The old one, it couldn't play music as well as a new one could. And as a result, the music wasn't as good as it could be. And the congregation grew unhappy with the old organ and its increasingly unpleasant sounds. We want a new organ. We want a new organ. We want something new. And so the young pastor came upon a wonderful new organ. It was much less expensive than a large pipe organ. You see, this really wasn't an organ, but it was a digitally recorded keyboard capable of reproducing all the sounds of the world's greatest organs. It even produced human voices, which could, in essence, make it sound like they had tripled the size of the choir. We must have that. We've got to have that. That's the instrument that we want. In addition to the wonderful sound of their new organ, it could record the hymns and music of the worship service. So with just the press of a button on a computer, the music, it would play through the impressive sound system. The organist didn't even need to be there on Sunday morning. And soon the organist realized this, and she would pre-record all of the music for the worship service on Friday afternoon. And then on Sunday morning, she could go and watch her daughter play soccer. The congregation was so impressed with the music that they forgave the organist. And when the music was recorded, it was flawless. The pastor was a bit of a perfectionist himself, appreciated it. No mistakes. And then to liven things up, the pastor brought in some contemporary Christian music and played it through his smartphone, which was synced up with the sound system. And soon the pastor discovered that there was no need for a choir. The recorded music of the world's greatest choirs could be played and shared for the adoring congregation. Again, no mistakes. It would be perfect. And soon, the choir members, well, they began to find other ways to express their creative outlets. Some went to other churches to sing in their choirs, while others would just sleep late on Sunday morning. This didn't bother the pastor because the music was perfect. The pastor began to record the worship services, and he was so pleased with the way that everything sounded. The sermon was crystal clear because of his new wireless microphones. Again, the music was perfect. And he wanted so much to preserve these perfect worship services that he recorded them all with the latest recording technology. And then the pastor shared all of the recordings with the congregation. They really enjoyed them. They quickly became the biggest source of evangelism. People, they lent them to others, and they were being passed around to everyone in the community. And everyone said, "What a beautiful church service they have." As the snow blanketed the ground, many parishioners found it difficult to get to church one Sunday morning. But they didn't worry, because there was a recorded version of the service on various streams of social media. The pastor couldn't understand it. Fewer and fewer people were attending worship services, even though they had never sounded more perfect. But still, there were people showing up to the church, and the pastor was so proud of the sound system and the technology and the social media that he introduced to the church. But then there came a Sunday when the pastor couldn't be there. He was going to be away on vacation, and he didn't want any other pastor using all of that wonderful technology, the sound system and the music and all of that other stuff. It was way too sophisticated, and they would probably just mess it up anyway. So he came into the church the Friday before, and he pre-recorded his sermon. What a tremendous success this video was. Whenever he made a mistake, he just edited it out. Oh, his presentation was flawless. His sermon was never better. He could edit out the motorcycles and all of the trucks going by and when the church bell started to ring in the middle of the sermon. Yes, he could edit all of that out. It was perfect. And this became such a successful technique that the pastor decided to do it every single week. So during the worship service, when it came time for the sermon, a giant screen lowered from the ceiling and a projector showed a video of his sermon, complete with audio and visual cues. He was so proud of the videos that he posted on YouTube and the church's Facebook page. Some of those videos even went viral. And then the local access cable news channel, they began showing the worship services each week, several times a week, in fact. And pretty soon that worship service began to bump the more popular shows and found itself in the primetime slots. And then he showed others how to work the multimedia audiovisual equipment. What a great ministry. What a great way to get others involved. And people seemed to really like this. And then one day, the pastor accidentally slept late and missed church. But it was okay, because they had everything pre-recorded, so they forgave the minister. It wasn't long before the entire congregation slept in on Sunday morning. They all watched it on their smartphones and their iPads, and they forgave each other. But it was okay, because they were wired in and connected to the congregational church. They were all friends and followers, but nobody was really connected to that beautiful church. The video ran, the sound system rang with life, but the pews were empty. The worship had ended. The church is the people. It's not a building. It's not technology. It's about God's people. And there's no perfect church and no perfect worship service and no perfect pastor. There's going to be mistakes by the organist, by the choir, and by the pastor, and there's even going to be mistakes in the bulletin from time to time. I think it's one of the things that makes this church so beautiful. It's not perfect. Our mission and our vision is about connecting people with the love of God. That's our investment in the church. And we want to demonstrate God's Spirit through worship and witness and ministry to the needs of the people in the church and the community. And we won't ever be perfect. But every time that we put God's Spirit on display through our unique worship and witness, then it is a perfect ministry. Amen. It's now time for us to come to the communion table. So before I begin the communion service, if you'd like to pause the service at this time and to go and get some bread, some juice, or some water, or coffee, or anything that you would like to share as part of the elements of communion, you are welcome to do it at this time. And I want you to know that all, absolutely all, are welcome to come to the table, this virtual table in this virtual space. You are always welcome to receive in this place. This table is for open to all who confess Jesus as the Christ, for all who seek to follow in Christ's way. Come to this sacred table, not because you must, but because you may. Come not because you are fulfilled, but because in your emptiness you stand in need of God's mercy and assurance. Come not to express an opinion, but to seek a presence and to pray for a spirit. Come to this table then, sisters and brothers, as you are. Partake and share. It is spread for you and for me, that we might again know that God has come to us, shared our common lot, and invited us to join the people of God's new age. Let us pray. Jesus, I am not worthy to have you come under my roof, but only say the word, and your servant will be healed. God of all mercy, we confess before you and each other that we have been unfaithful to you. We lack love for our neighbors, we waste opportunities to do good, and we look the other way when you cry out to us in the suffering of our brothers and sisters in need. We are sincerely sorry for our sins, both those we commit deliberately and those that we allow to overtake us. And we ask your forgiveness and pray for strength, that we may follow in your way and love all your people with that perfect love which casts out fear. Through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer. Hear these comforting words. If you repent and believe in God's redeeming mercy, your sins are forgiven. Trust in God's promises and begin anew your life with God and all people in the name of Jesus Christ. Let us continue in the spirit of prayer. Holy God, we praise you and bless you for your creation, for the gift of life, and for your abiding love which brings us close to you, the source of all blessing. We thank you for revealing your will for us in the giving of the law and in the preaching of the prophets. We thank you especially that in the fullness of time, you sent Jesus, and we rejoice that in a perfect victory over the grave, you raised Christ with power to become sovereign in your realm. And we celebrate the coming of the Holy Spirit to gather your church, by which your work may be done in the world, and through which we share the gift of eternal life. With the faithful in every place and time, we praise with joy your holy name. We remember that in the night of betrayal and desertion, Jesus took bread, gave you thanks, he broke the bread, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, also after the supper, Jesus took the cup and said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Bless us, therefore, by your Holy Spirit, that as we receive the bread and the fruit of the vine at this table, we may offer you our faith and praise. We may be united with Christ and with one another, and we may continue faithful in all things. In the strength Christ gives us, we offer ourselves to you, eternal God, and give thanks that you have called us to serve you. Through the broken bread, we participate in the body of Christ. And through the cup of blessing, we participate in the blood of Christ. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Let us take them in remembrance that Christ died and raised for each of us. Come, for all things are ready.
Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving.
The body of Christ, broken for you. The blood of the new covenant poured out for you. Let us pray. We thank you, God, for inviting us to this table where we have known the presence of Christ and have received all Christ's gifts. Strengthen our faith, increase our love for one another, and let us show forth your praise in our lives. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. May God bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May God look upon you now with kindness and give you peace. Amen.